there's a common lay belief that memory works like a recording device. You just record the experience and later on you play it back. But that is not the way memory actually works. Memory is actually more of a constructive process. When we remember something, we're actually taking bits and pieces of experience, bringing them together to essentially construct what feels like an actual memory. So I like to say that memory works a little bit more like a Wikipedia page, because you can go in there and edit it, but so can other people. If you ask somebody, how fast were the cars going when they smashed into each other? You're going to get a higher estimate of speed on the average than if you ask a question with a more neutral verb like hit. How fast were the cars going when they hit each other? The early questions could affect the answer that people gave to some totally different question that you put to them often much later. So if I ask you how fast were the cars going when they smashed into each other, later on you're more likely to tell me you saw broken glass at the scene, even though there wasn't any broken glass. These leading questions, they contain misleading information that can contaminate a person's memory. We get contaminated when we talk to other witnesses, when we're interrogated in a suggestive or leading manner. We get contaminated if we've seen a high publicity event and then we see some newspaper or television coverage about that event. All of these situations provide an opportunity for new information to enter a witness's memory and cause a contamination, transformation, distortion, or even just a supplementation of the memory. So what the scientific work on memory distortion is revealing about the nature of memory is that it is malleable. It's not something that's fixed. It's subject to distortion or change or exaggeration, and that's why we talk about the malleable nature of memory. But when it comes to somebody's liberty, even very small errors in memory can make a really big difference about somebody's freedom. So it matters what the color of the jacket of the perpetrator or the facial hair or other things that people are trying to remember when they try to remember a past crime. Many people are just not aware of how many mistakes people can make. And when they are making a mistake and they're testifying, they can often be very detailed and very confident and even emotional in their testimony. We began to study this process, and one of the first studies that I did involved using the power of suggestion to get people to believe and remember when they were 5 or 6 years old. They were lost in a shopping mall with certain family members present in a certain place, and we used suggestive interviewing to plant these memories. And we got about a quarter of otherwise healthy adults to believe and remember all or part of this made-up experience. There is now a string of experiments using this kind of lost-in-the-mall technique where ordinary people have been led to believe that they nearly drowned and had to be rescued by a lifeguard, that they were attacked by a vicious animal, that they committed a crime as a teenager, when none of these things actually happened. And so we now refer to these as rich false memories. You can plant a little seed, and through the power of suggestion, it can grow into something very big and rich and detailed. One of the things that jurors are impressed with when they listen to a witness's testimony, if it's expressed with a lot of confidence, if it's expressed with a lot of detail, if it's expressed with emotion, the jurors tend to believe it more. But what we've shown is that people can be very confident about false memories, people can be detailed about false memories, people can be emotional about false memories. You need independent corroboration to know whether you are dealing with an actual memory or one that is a product of imagination, suggestion, or one of these other processes. We would all benefit if we have a more educated society about the workings of memory. particularly in the criminal justice system, if people are just not quite so willing to embrace and accept uncritically a detailed, confident, emotional memory, but to really ask, you know, exactly how was this sausage made? And not just accept it as being true and authentic just because it's expressed in this way, we'd all be better off.